Welcome to week number four. This is the title of this week is entitled Methods in Computational Chemistry, and this will be our first introduction into some of the different types of methods in computational chemistry, and we will revisit this topic in great detail in subsequent weeks. So let's get started. The guiding question that really addresses this particular week's topic is question number four in the list we gave you several weeks ago. And that question says, there are roughly four different flavors to computational chemistry: ab initio methods, semi-empirical methods, density functional theory, and molecular mechanics, molecular dynamics, otherwise known as MM and MD. And what are these methods and how do they differ? So this beginning conversation on methods in computational chemistry will introduce you to these four different methods, including a beginning introduction to some of the mathematics that's involved. At this stage in your computational chemistry career, the mathematics will be a little overwhelming and intimidating, but we will get to it in a little bit more detail in subsequent weeks, so I would encourage you not to get too worried. Okay, let's go ahead and move on. Okay, so methods of computational chemistry. Here's a really good picture that talks about the big picture of methods in computational chemistry. At the top of the picture there, we have the box entitled molecular modeling, and that's another name for computational chemistry, as you know by now. So there are roughly three different types of molecular models. The first one, and unfortunately the nomenclature is a little bit misleading. A lot of these terms are used differently by different people. Some of them are used synonymously, so it's a little bit misleading at times. But the first type is known as empirical, or just plain old molecular modeling. Empirical is probably a better term. Now, empirical, that word means data-driven. Okay, so in empirical, we have some existing data. And the main thing that you need to know about empirical molecular models is they really neglect electrons. So they are only concerned with modeling what's the behavior of the nucleus or the nuclei in an atom or in molecules. So empirical methods neglect electrons. They don't pay any attention to electrons at all. We'll be significantly less interested in this particular approach throughout the course. This is really a because this is a quantum chemistry course, we really care about what the electrons are doing, and so this particular approach is less of interest, but we'll talk about it a little bit. Okay, moving over to the right a little bit, the second type there you see is called semi-empirical, and semi, as you should know, means some, and empirical means data, so that phrase there means some data. And what we do here in semi-empirical methods is we have some existing data already built into the computer model. The rest of the data is calculated when we run our calculation. And one of the major differences in, and this is in an electron method, so we are looking at electrons, but if you recall from basic chemistry, the concept of valence electrons and inner shell electrons or core electrons. So in semi-empirical methods, we can speed up our computing and speed up our computation by neglecting all of the electrons that are really close to the nucleus and only calculate what's happening with the electrons on the outside or the valence electrons. And I hope that makes sense. Now, there's a phrase there that says approximate or parameterize HF integrals. And when we get into some of our mathematics, we'll talk a little bit more about that in some detail. So for now, don't worry about that particular statement. Okay, moving over to the far right, we have, and these are categorized in the same box, but oftentimes people will draw four boxes with these being separate things. But I'm going to put them in the same box for now. We'll talk about the differences later on. So ab initio or DFT, ab initio means from the beginning or from scratch. You should recognize the Latin root word there, initial, and ab means from. So ab initio means starting from scratch. We want to calculate everything we can possibly calculate on the behavior of the electrons. So the box underneath there says we're taking a full accounting of the electrons, whereas the empirical way completely neglects electrons. ab initio and DFT, or density functional theory, only pay attention to electrons and actually will ignore the behavior of the nuclei, as you'll see in the next several weeks. So here's sort of a big picture that you need to keep in mind as we go through the next several weeks. And again, we'll spend a considerable amount of time on each of these methods, more on semi-empirical, ab initio, and DFT than on empirical, but you'll become experts in all of these particular areas. Okay, I'm going to give you a real quick snapshot of each of the three or four methods now. I'm actually going to talk about four of them because I'm going to separate ab initio from DFT. But let's talk about molecular mechanics, and this is the empirical modeling that I talked about in the very first box on the left-hand side of the last picture. And this assumes atoms to be like spheres at the end of a spring. So if you can imagine a nucleus of a molecule being connected as if they're connected to a spring, and what we do is we pull those nuclei far apart, let them go, and what happens if you have two balls that are connected to a spring and you pull them far apart and you let them go? Well, they vibrate, okay? They move back and forth until such point as they run out of energy, then they stop vibrating. But when we study molecules this way, we're really using classical mechanics, and what that means is basic everyday physics. And some of you may be familiar with Hooke's law. Force is equal to a force constant times x, the distance the things are apart. Some of you may be familiar with Newton's second law, force equals mass times acceleration. So molecular mechanics really uses plain old everyday physics to calculate the behavior of molecules. And we use this for exclusively. Molecular mechanics is a very good tool that we use for molecules of 100 atoms or more. And actually, that number 100 should probably be more like 1,000, really big molecules. So what might those be? Proteins are really big molecules. Drugs are really big molecules. A lot of biological compounds in chemistry are really large molecules, hundreds of atoms, thousands of atoms. Because as you will learn a little bit in this lecture and certainly in subsequent weeks, we can't use the more sophisticated methods like ab initio or DFT on molecules that have a lot of atoms. So when you have a lot of atoms, you're doing a protein like we'll do in medicinal chemistry, or pharmaceuticals like we're doing in medicinal chemistry, we will be limited to using an empirical method, otherwise known as molecular mechanics, as the only way we can get an answer to our particular problem. All right, in molecular mechanics, energy is the sum of some contributions, and those are known as a force field. You're going to see things like MMFF 94, and MMFF 94 stands for the Merck Mechanics Force Field. Merck is a drug company, and you can think about why a drug company would be interested in molecular mechanics, because they're calculating the behavior of drugs, which are big molecules. And a force field has these four contributions. And again, if you can, in your mind, think about taking two tennis balls, attaching them to a spring, and what can you do with those? Well, we can stretch them, okay? We can pull them apart and stretch the spring, okay? What else can we do with those two balls connected to a spring? Well, we can bend the spring, and that's called a distortion from a bond angle. Okay. What else can we do with a spring? Well, we can twist those two balls, and they could, make a torsion around the spring. So those are all measures of how those two nuclei, in this case, again, there's no electrons involved, how those will behave. There's other contributions like van der Waals and Coulomb forces that you might have run across, but for now we'll leave those alone. The mathematics below there shows what the mathematics looks like, and what we're saying there is the total energy is equal to, and that fancy E-looking thing is is sigma, which means add up. So we're adding up all of the stretching energies, we're adding up all the bending energies, we're adding up all of the dihedral angles, we're adding up all of these different contributions, and that's giving us our total energy, which again is always what we're trying to do in computational chemistry. And again, as I mentioned a minute ago, a typical parameter set, and that's what this is called, would be MMFF94. And again, this stands for Merck Molecular Force Field 94. That's the year it was developed. And this was developed by Merck Pharmaceuticals because, again, they're very interested in doing computational studies on large molecules like drugs. Okay, so that's molecular mechanics. Okay. The next method that we will use a tremendous amount, you already have used it a lot. Anytime you use the program called MOPAC, you are using a semi-empirical method. And this is used for calculations of molecules, oh, between 50 and 100 atoms. Okay, that range is not rock solid, but it's just a ballpark idea of where molecules run. And semi-empirical, as the name suggests, is a little bit of experimental and a little bit of ab initio. So what we do is, ab initio means calculating all of the numbers from scratch, okay, and empirical means some data. So what we do is we take some data from the experimental lab, from the traditional chemistry labs, and we mix that in with some data that's being calculated by the computer. So some of the data that we need to solve these problems using semi-empirical is already coded into the software. Okay, somebody's already typed in some of the data, and that sum means semi. Semi means sum. Okay, so semi-empirical means some data is already built into the computer model, and the advantage of that is twofold. We can do bigger molecules, 50 to 100 atoms, and the calculations go faster. Okay, if some of the answer is already calculated for you, then you don't have as many calculations to do and you get your answer faster. And semi-empirical methods have an advantage of being really well suited for studying how molecules behave in solution, like in water. Okay, a little bit about semi-empirical mathematics. We'll spend a lot of time talking about semi-empirical math. And as we say here, the mathematics are restricted to the valence electrons. We only care about the electrons that are on the very outside of the atom or the molecule. The ones, the electrons that are inside, close to the nucleus, we don't care about those because they probably aren't going to be doing, they aren't going to be helping with the reaction anyway. Okay? So, but we still have to, we can't ignore them completely, so how do we deal with these missing electrons? Well, the slide here says that the parameterized data sets are added. And what that means is we have already coded in the software, all of the data that explains the behavior of the inner electrons or the core electrons. Okay, so when you do a semi-empirical calculation, what you are doing is you are determining what's the behavior, or what are the valence electrons, the electrons outside, on the outside of the molecule, what are they doing? The electrons that are on the inside of the atom or molecule, the data has already been calculated and it just is already stored in the computer for you. There are three methods, and you've already run into these. The Austin Model 1, or otherwise known as AM1, and it's called the Austin Method because it was developed at the University of Texas at Austin. And as you have seen, this predicts the heat of formation. Okay, you have some experience with PM3 or parametric method number 3, and this is I call this AM1 on steroids, meaning this is a more powerful version of AM1, and it's more powerful because the parameters are better. Okay, the data that's been typed into the computer is better data than the data for AM1. So PM3 is a really good semi-empirical method to use on a regular basis. And as the slide here says, if you have an organic system, PM3 is a really good method to use when you're studying organics. We've all run into the ENDO methods, which stands for neglect of differential overlap. We talked a little bit about those last week. There's MINDO, which is modified intermediate neglect of differential overlap. There's INDO, intermediate neglect of differential overlap. There's ZINDO, there's ZINDO1. There's a whole variety of these ENDO methods. We won't spend too much time talking about these methods, but we will chat about them in a little bit more detail later on. Okay. Now we're getting into, so the empirical and the semi-empirical are sort of in their own category, but now we're going to talk about quantum methods. And the two major methods here are the ab initio method and the DFT method. So now we're going to separate these guys a little bit. So this flow chart here shows, starting on the left, there's two basically forms of quantum methods. There's one that studies something called a wave function, and there's something that studies what's called a density function, okay, which is where, of course, the name density functional theory comes from. Wave function, anytime you're doing a wave function, and we'll talk about this a tremendous amount, basically that is an ab initio method. So you sort of have to get it in your heads that a wave function is considered to be an ab initio method. And there are roughly three categories of wave function methods. So there are roughly three categories of ab initio methods. One is Hartree-Fock, otherwise known as an HF method. The second is Mollier-Plessett, otherwise known as MP. And the third one is what's called a configuration interaction, which is cleverly abbreviated as CI. Okay, so there are more methods under wave function or under ab initio than these three, but these are the three basic that we'll be spending some time on. Okay, under density function, there's only one method, and that's called density functional theory, or DFT. Okay, let's talk about these in a little bit more detail. Ab initio methods, as I've said before, is Latin for from scratch, or from the beginning, or from first principles. And we use this for calculations of 1 to 50 atoms, what we call a small molecule. And we can only use small molecules because every single piece of data has to be calculated by hand, or from scratch, or from the beginning. So we're not at the stage yet computationally where we can do large molecules using ab initio methods, although it's getting better. And all the results come from significant computational analysis of what's known as Schrödinger's equation, which is the equation we'll start talking about, I think, next week. And as you might suspect, this is considered to be the most accurate method, but it's also the most computationally expensive. And if you recall our discussion of several weeks ago, computationally expensive means it takes a lot of computing time to get an answer. Okay, so ab initio methods are only used on small molecules because every single piece of data has to be calculated by the computer. Okay, some real quick considerations. Here's a little bit of math. So it says here, for example, the computational expense scales as the fourth power of the number of atomic orbitals. And we'll do a little lab on this in a week or two. So I have here n being the number of atomic orbitals and being n to the fourth. So what this really means, all this stuff on dependence on number of electrons and 3n spatial coordinates and all this kind of stuff. Okay. What all of this means is the more electrons you get, the really significantly more computing power and more computing time you need. Okay, the problem, if you add 10 electrons, the problem is not 10 times bigger. Okay, the problem is 10 to the fourth bigger. So it gets really out of hand very quickly. Okay, with ab initio, the computer cannot generate an exact answer for us. It only can give us a ballpark answer. And so another term that you will hear sometimes when you hear the term ab initio, okay, another term for that is people will say we're using an SCF, or self-consistent field method. Okay, so, and it's an iterative technique, meaning the computer goes round and around and around and around until it gets tired of computing or thinks it has the right answer. And that's called an SCF method. Self-consistent field means the computer stops when it thinks it's done, and we'll talk about that. Okay, there is a significant deficiency in ab initio methods, otherwise known as Hartree-Fock methods, otherwise known as SCF methods. What we would love to be able to do is get the exact solution to the energy. We can't do that. Okay, all we can get in is an approximation, and there's some issues there. You see energy, Hartree-Fock, and energy of correlation. There's some things there we have to calculate in order to get an exact energy. And again, we can't get the exact energy at this stage in computational chemistry. Okay, some other methods, and again, this is just an introduction, so I don't expect you to, nor am I going to take time to explain all these. There are some real problems with the HF method, or the Hartree-Fock method, and Mollier-Plessett, otherwise known as MP, tries to fix some of these problems, and we'll spend some time in the next couple of weeks talking about what are the problems with HF and why are they a problem and how do we fix them. Okay, so it gives you a procedure there of how we fix the HF method in MP, and we'll come back to that and talk about that when we get into ab initio methods. But you see there it calculates an answer, then it moves some electrons from one place to another, and then it recalculates what the electrons are doing after they've been moved, and then we put the electrons back where they're supposed to be, and then we get our final answer. And there's a variety of MP methods. If you look on the server, I think there's an MP2 method. I think there's an MP4 method. And MP2 means second order Mollier plus at mathematics. And again, we'll talk about those in detail later on. Configuration interaction, or CI, also is a way of looking at where the electrons are, and we can move them in different places, put them in different configurations, and then we can mix them all up and see how they behave, and based on that we can say something intelligent about the energy of the molecule. So we'll get into some of these when we get into the chapter on ab initio methods in a couple weeks. Okay, again, here's a little bit more on this, and I'm going to breeze through this because, again, we'll come back to this. Okay, one of the problems with HF, real briefly, is it doesn't do a good job of understanding how electrons are moving, and that's a problem. It doesn't do a good job with dealing with the fact that electrons have a spin. You should remember from chemistry that electrons can have spin up and spin down. Okay, so there's a variety of things that it doesn't do very well. And again, that's where we use these other methods like MP and CI to try to fix some of this. And this slide gives you a little bit more detail on the variations of CI. So what you see there is CIS, which is a single substitution method, CID, double substitution, CISD, single and double substitution, full CI, which is almost a complete analysis using CI methods. And you got limited CI, which is QCISD, quadratic configuration, interaction, single, double substitution. My goodness, I hope you appreciate we have some work cut out for us over the next couple of weeks to get our heads around all these different things. And we will get there, and it'll just take a little bit of work and a little bit of time. This is just a beginning introduction to what's coming down the pike. Okay, density functional theories we'll talk about in more detail later on. You should now know there is something called a wave function. You don't know exactly what it is yet, but you should know there's something called a wave function. And one of the problems with a wave function is it doesn't exist in real molecules. It's a mathematical piece of fiction. Okay, wave functions are just a mathematical description of what we think is happening in the atom or the molecule. It doesn't really exist. Okay, whereas electron density, okay, is actually a physical property. It actually exists in real atoms and molecules. Okay, and we can actually measure that. So one of the advantages of density functional theory is it does calculations on something that really exists, not some mathematical theory like the wave function does. And we'll talk about why that's good and why that's not good in the next couple weeks. And the thing that should really catch your eye on the next bullet down is DFT does two things for us. It reduces the number of integrations or the number of calculus problems that the computer has to solve. And because it reduces the number of calculus problems that need to be solved, it simplifies the computations. It can also help us predict some properties like electronegativity, hardness and softness, reactivity indices, and again, we'll get into this later on. And no, there does not exist a book entitled Density Functional Theory for Dummies, at least not that I know of. Okay, so that's DFT. A little bit about the mathematics here. Again, this is going to make your eyeballs bug out, again, what you should notice here is what we really care about calculating is the energy, and we do that with a variety of ways. You see in there we have some repulsion, we have some attraction, okay, and those are things that you should have had some experience with before. There's something in there called exchange and correlation functionals, and again, we will get into all of this notation when we get to the chapter on DFT. Right now, this should look very intimidating, but again, I assure you we will take this apart in very slow steps, and by the time you're ready to get to the stuff, you'll have a good idea what you're looking at. Questions. There should be a lot of questions after this week, so we'll talk about them during video conference. Send me email, put them in your notebook, and we'll look forward to seeing you online and in the video conference. Thanks very much.